lift our Savior up in praise. Yeah. Instead of praise, nobody other than Jesus Christ. Let's all stand up for the Lord in prayer. Let's lift our hands this morning. Let's lift our voice. Let's praise the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for all he's done for us, for his goodness and his mercy enduring forever and ever. Lord, we thank you, God, for your love, your mercy, God, the power that you've given us to live above sin, to live a victorious life, not just one day, not just 2 days or a week or two, but every day of our life, as long as we keep our head in the master's hand. It's so good to love you, Jesus. It's so good to serve you, Jesus. We appreciate you. We love you, God. Have your way and move in a special way in this service, God. Hallelujah. Give God a hand up on you. Turn the page, amen.
Amen.
Just say glory to his name. Not to those of every name, not to a politician's name, not to anybody else's name, but the glory belongs to Jesus Christ. The glory belongs to God. Hallelujah.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin.
Thank you.
against all evil.
Taking care of us, taking care of all four of us. All you have to do is come in.
available and it's waiting for you this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness. Let's take some time to pray.
Thank you, God, for salvation.
Just tell God that you thank for
grace.
For whatever it is.
Thank you, God.
Thank you for your love, Jesus. Your mercy, God. God, for another opportunity to wake up. Another opportunity to get up and do something for you, to do something for others, Father. To praise your name. To make your name large and known around among others, Father. We appreciate you, Jesus. We love you. Thank you, Jesus. Tell God thank you. Say thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. God, do something special for me. That's not selfish. You want God to bless others, but remember, you go God to bless you also. I pray for other people. I do. You know, as Christians, we love other people, but God also wants to bless us personally. He's the God of everybody, but he wants to bless you also. Don't think that God doesn't want to do something for you. Don't think that God wants to pass you by. God wants to stop right where you at and bless you. He has something special just for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for all you've done, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul. Thank you for making me whole.
Yes.
Oh, God, thank you. Thank you, God, for setting me free.
Amen.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you. It's good to be in God's house this morning. You may be seated. It's such a blessing to be in God's house on this Father's Day. And I thought about something this morning when it relates to Father's Day. And I thought about this song I heard and how this guy, he was singing with his dad. And he was real happy to be singing with his dad. And he talked about how he loved his dad. But then he thought about people that didn't have fathers. He said, you know what? He said, some of y'all don't have no daddy. And whether your dad was there, but maybe absent at part of times out of your life, or maybe he was at the house, but maybe he was abusive, or you know, maybe he just didn't spend time with you, or maybe he just didn't grow up with the dad. But what this guy was saying, he said, you know, he loves his dad.
Yes.
Amen. He loves him. He was talking about, you know, his dad that he was, you know, singing with in his band, his group he was in. But then he said, some of y'all don't got no daddy. But then he stopped and said, won't God be a father for you?
Yes, amen.
Won't he be a father for you? He's a father for the fatherless.
Yes.
If you need something, you don't have to hold back. You can go right to your daddy. You can go right to your father and say, God, I need something.
Yes.
I'm your child.
Thank
and if you don't know God as your personal Savior, you say, God, I need a father. I need someone to save me. I need someone to lift me up. God, help me. He'll be a father for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Happy Father's Day to everybody here. You know, amen. With children, and I want to say happy Father's Day to my Lord, my Savior, my God. I appreciate you, Jesus, all you do. Every day we should lift people up in prayer. But every day we should praise God and lift our real Father up in prayer. The Father that never slumbers or sleeps, that earthly Father is asleep, and, you know, he's out doing things. That Heavenly Father is always looking down upon us, taking care of our every needs. Even when you don't think he's doing something, he's moving.
Oh,
he's
working. Amen.
He doesn't forget about us.
Amen.
People say, well, I got it bad. You know what? Well, I'm sure you could have it a lot worse if it wasn't for God.
That's right.
You say, well, I have bills that need to be taken care of. You say, well, you're still living, aren't you?
All right.
You still, you know, you're still in the house. You're not homeless. And even if you're homeless, I see homeless people that are taken care of.
That's right.
God provides for everybody. He loves all men, all people, every race, every nationality. He is a father. Not for just one few people. Not for just a group of people or a country, but he's a father of all. Even to those that don't know him, he blesses them anyway.
Amen.
Hallelujah. At this time, we're going to take up an offering for our Father.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Take up a good offering for God this Father's Day. And we're going to dedicate this, as we always do, but I just want to mention it. We're going to take this to God as you're giving an offering. And if you're online and you want to give, click that link in there and just give God a good Father's Day offering. Say, God, I appreciate you. I love you. I give. But today I want to give, you know, a little special. Even if it's the same that you give every week, just say, God, I give this to you. Happy Father's Day. I love you. And I want to be a blessing to your work and your program so that we may reach others for Jesus Christ.
Yes,
amen. Pastor Watson, help us see the Sunday morning time off.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to be gathered together in your name, and we thank you for all the blessings that we have in you. We pray that you would receive this offering with our thanks and faithfulness unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. Example in himself to follow, and we see throughout scripture that he's given us good examples to emulate. When Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, he said, which of you, if your son would ask for bread, would you give him a stone? Which of you, if your son would ask for an egg, would you give him a scorpion? Or if he asked a fish, would you give him a serpent? How much more, if you being evil would give good gifts to your children, how much more would your heavenly Father give? Yes. the Holy Spirit to those that ask Him. He said in the book of Hebrews that our fathers in this life chasten us. That means they correct us, they discipline us according to their own wills. Our dads have rules for the household, and they would discipline us if we broke or violated those rules. Our dads had standards that they set for us, and they did that, as God said in His Word, according to their own pleasure, the standards that they set for the household. But when God disciplines us, when God sets us back in line, it's for our own good. So we really do, as fathers, have a great responsibility, but we have a greater example in our Heavenly Father that we can look to when we say, God, I don't know what to do with these kids. So right. God, what would you have me to do with these kids?
Amen.
But it really is a great responsibility. And I was looking up some things the other day about fathers and the impact that fathers have in children's lives and in the family. And you can read all kinds of studies, all kinds of reports done on households that don't have fathers in them. And you can see how really detrimental it is to not just the child, not just the family, but to society as a whole. To see the impact that simply having the father in the household with the child makes. And when the father's absent, how much it can hurt the child, the family, society. But even when it comes to serving God, there was a study done by a men's ministry group, a very large men's ministry group, where it said if a father does not go to church, even if the mother does, only one in 50 children will become a regular church attendee. If a father does not go to church, even if the mother does, only one in 50 children will become a regular church attendee. Now, we know there's more to serving God than just going to church. And going to church is not the one thing that makes a person a Christian. But going to church is one of the things that identifies a person as a Christian. And a lot of people would say, oh, you don't have to go to church to be a Christian. But remember, the word Christian, the literal word, means Christ-like. It means we do the things that Christ set the example of doing in His ministry here on the earth. And one of the things that the Bible says is that He went into the synagogue as was His custom. He always went to the synagogue. So if there was anybody that could say you don't have to go to church to be a Christian, it would have been Christ Himself. But what do we see Him doing? We see Him always going and meeting together with the believers. So if a father does not go to church, even if the mother does, only one in 50 children will become a regular church attendee. If the father does go to church regularly, even if the mother does not, then between two-thirds and three-quarters, so that would be between, out of 50, that would be between 33 and 35, somewhere in that ballpark, 33 and 40, between two-thirds and three-quarters of the children will be regular church attendees. So you see, the spiritual leadership that God gave families really is something that can be measured. The impact, the influence. If a father does not go to church, even if the mother does, only one in 50 children will become a regular church attendee. If the father does go regularly, even if the mother does not, then between two-thirds and three-quarters of the children will be regular church attendees. If the father attends church sometimes, irregularly, then between half and two-thirds of the children will still attend church sometimes as adults. So the influence of a father, it can be measured. It makes a huge difference. And so I see here before us fathers who are faithful in serving God. And I see here before us fathers whose influence on their children is favorable towards their children's becoming faithful to God themselves. It's something that is very important. It's a responsibility that God has given fathers to pass on that legacy of faithfulness to their children. Right. And I know that we'll often make mistakes. We look at that situation, we say, I could have done something better. Of course, in any person's life, fathers, mothers, children, if you don't have a family, in any person's life, you can look at the situation and say, I could have done that better. But you can always be faithful to God and make it better when you have the opportunity.
Right.
And that faithfulness, regardless of if you make a mistake, that faithfulness in correcting it, children see that also. Mm-hmm. But they can also see faking it.
Yes, sir.
So that faithfulness is more important than messing up. The faithfulness in making it right and saying, I'm going to do right by God and by my family, is something that really honors God and has an impact on the children. So praise God. Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. Taking our Bible reading this morning from the book of Hebrews chapter 11. Wonderful chapter of scripture. I'm going to refer to many places but not read the whole thing. I do encourage you to read Hebrews chapter 11 if you have not read it already. Hebrews chapter 11 verses 1 and 2. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Again, that's Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. Faith is the evidence of things hoped, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Verse 2 says, for by it the elders obtained a good report. And with the help of the Lord this morning, we'll be preaching a message with the title, Legacy. Amen. Reverend Brooks, sir, would you please pray over the message and the messenger this morning?
Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for your presence in your house this morning, Father. So good to be here, Father, to listen and get our hearts prepared for what you have for us, Father. Bless Pastor Watson as he preaches your word, God. Get him with fresh action of the Holy Ghost. God, open our hearts to receive, Father, this day in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. The word legacy is used in many contexts, but it is what a person passes on to another. It may be an inheritance after their death that after I have passed on, my children may receive, they'll get a whole bunch of books when I'm gone. And that would be the legacy that I leave to them. And they'll remember me and say, oh, what I got from my dad. And hopefully they'd also say, I remember going to church and hearing my dad preach. And I remember his faithfulness to God. And that we would serve God. And that even when times were hard, God would be faithful to us because dad was faithful to God. But what they would actually receive and be able to put their hands on would be a bunch of books. But the legacy is what they would remember and what would be most important to them of what I left behind to them. A legacy may be inheritance that a person passes on to another after they die. It may be a lesson taught by a teacher to a student. This is what I remember. That teacher's not dead. She's still back at the school that I went to. But this is what I remember. This is what she taught me. I'll never remember. It wasn't even part of the lesson. But it was just how she expressed her joy in learning to the kids. And it really encouraged us. It motivated us to learn, to read, perhaps to enjoy the subject matter that we had to receive. It made us want to learn. The legacy. In Hebrews 11, we read of a legacy of faith that's been passed on through many generations. From times of old, the Old Testament figures who lived for God by faith. God having given them His word that something would come to pass. Are they trusting in God to fulfill what God said He would do? God to be true to His character, that those who would live for Him would be honored by Him. We read of that legacy of faith, the example that they left for us of serving God. The example set for us by these figures who it says in verse 13, all died in faith. These, of course, having been figures of the Old Testament, died thousands of years ago. They all died faithful to God. It says they all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off. and being persuaded of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Speaking specifically in this verse of Abraham, whom God gave that promise that he would go to a land that he would not receive for himself, but would be the inheritance that his children would receive. God had told him, Abraham, if you leave everything that you have here in this city behind and go to a land that I will promise to your children, then I will give it to your children.
Well, that's right.
And Abraham said, what is anything in this life for anyway? If God is faithful, then I've got much more in eternity by faith in God than I've got for 150 years in this life below.
Right.
And so Abraham said, okay, what is? And Abraham lived 150, 175, 220. So Abraham lived a long time. But he said, what are these years on earth if I've got faith in God for eternity? I'm just passing through a couple of years here below, but I'll trust in God.
Yes. Amen.
And so if God says, leave this all behind, God says, I won't see my blessings in this life, but my children will receive it because of my faithfulness, and I'll be blessed eternally in Him, then I'll leave this all behind. I'll let my children be blessed by my faithfulness, and I'll receive an eternal reward in Christ.
Yes, yes.
And so he left it all behind. And Abraham and Sarah and the others listed in Hebrews chapter 11, they leave us a legacy of what God accomplishes on behalf of those who are faithful to Him. Romans chapter 15, verse 4 says, whatsoever things were written aforetime, they were written for our learning. We were given this legacy, the Old Testament, showing that God is faithful to His word. God is faithful to those who are obedient to Him. God is miraculous when it seems that there's no way for us to be delivered from our problems. All we have to do is trust in God. We can see God part the Red Sea for the children of Israel when Moses called on Him. We can see God delivering the Hebrew children out of the fiery furnace when they took a stand for what was right and would not bow to the king. And He said, heat that furnace up seven times hotter. And even those that cast them into the furnace died by the heat, and they were standing outside of it. But they fell in, and they looked in, and they saw four, not the three that they cast in, but they saw four walking around. And when they called them out, not even their hair was singed, not even their clothes smelled like smoke.
Right.
And they said, God delivered us because we were faithful to Him.
Yes.
We would not bow to the king in His image. Whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of scriptures might have hope. What a blessing it is to see somebody who's gone before and has succeeded in what we attempt and hope to do. You ever be standing in line for something that doesn't seem pleasant from your perspective, and you're just hoping, I'm not the first in line. I'm hoping that I'll be maybe third or fourth back, close enough to get it over with quickly, but not the first one to have to do it.
All right.
We were at an event the other day, and everybody that was there was nervous. And it was the kids, they were doing something. And my kid, just by where they happened to sit down, they all sat down in a circle, and nobody told them where was the front of the line. But my kid sat down at the front of the line and had to go first. And I'm not going to tell you which one it is. Some of you already know what I'm talking about. But my kid sat down at the front of the line and was mad about having to go first. Didn't get an attitude, but we who can read our own child's expressions could tell this child is upset about going first, but didn't get an attitude, just we could read the expressions, but went through with it.
Yes.
And did well.
Yes.
And the rest of the kids that went after said, okay, now somebody's broken the ice, we don't have to be as nervous because we're only going third, fourth, fifth, whatever the case may be. Isn't it something that finds us in a calmer state when we're not the first ones to have to do something that we're apprehensive about? Abraham, the Bible says, was the first one to live for God by faith. The Bible says that he's the father of our faith.
Yes.
He was the first one to live for God based on a promise that God gave him that he did not see the fulfillment of. He was the first one that said, I will leave everything behind and go to a place that I haven't seen yet and go and wander around in a land that God says that I won't receive, but God says that my children after it will receive this. I'll do that because I know that God will do what he said. But Abraham's not the only one, though the Bible says that he's the first one that lived for God by faith according to the promise of God, which starts out Hebrews chapter 11 talking about Abel. Talks about Abel's sacrifice. And Abel just knew what God expected of him. And so in faithfulness to God, he said, I'm going to do what God requires of me. Regardless of what my brother's doing, my brother might have put a lot of effort into tilling his garden, into sowing the seeds, into raising it up. Maybe he put the right kind of fertilizer in there and was good at raising crops. And he brought the best fruit that he could from the ground to his sacrifice for God. But God doesn't require the fruit of the ground. He requires a blood offering for sin. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, where we're reading from, there is no, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. In order to remit the sins, in order to cover them up, in order to wash them away, there must be a blood sacrifice. And so Abel said, in order to be faithful to God, I must offer a blood sacrifice. I'm going to give him the firstlings of my flock. Abel might be doing what he thinks he can do, but Abel's not doing what God wants him to do.
That's right.
I'm going to do what God wants me to do. And so we read about the faithfulness of Abel and his sacrifice, and it cost him his life. We read about Enoch's translation, about how he saw the wickedness of the world around him, and he said, I'm going to live separately from the world. I'm going to walk with God regardless of what people in my generation are doing. And God took him. We read about Noah's deliverance and about how his whole family was protected by his faith in building the ark to spare himself and his family from the judgment of God. Abraham's obedience in leaving his home behind. Sarah's strength when God told her that she would have a child beyond childbearing years. Abraham's obedience again in offering Isaac as a sacrifice. It says in verse 19 that he was willing to go through with the sacrifice. God, we read in the book of Genesis about how God stopped him right as he was about to plunge that knife into Isaac's heart. But it says that he would have gone through with it because he accounted that God was able to raise him up even from the dead.
Yes, that's right.
God told Abraham, sacrifice your son. That work was already accomplished in Abraham's heart as he raised that knife. And if Sarah was standing by there, if a servant was standing by there, if an angel came and stood by there and told Abraham, stop, it was already going to happen. But God himself told Abraham, stop.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
Sometimes people say, I'll go this far to show God that I'll do what he said. But then when they think the sacrifice is close enough, they'll back up because now God sees that I'll go this far. But unless God is the one that says, now I see that you'll not withhold from me, then follow through with it.
Yeah.
Follow through with it. Abraham already accomplished it in his heart, and he was going to accomplish it in Isaac's heart. Because he accounted that God was able to raise him up from the dead. Abraham knew about the resurrection. And he said, if I kill Isaac here, Isaac's the one that the promise is going to be fulfilled through.
That's right. Yes, sir.
So even if he's dead on this altar, God will raise him up again.
That's right. Amen.
We read about Isaac's blessing. When he blessed his sons, declaring his own faith to his sons, that he would, though he would not see the fulfillment of his own blessings over Jacob and Esau. We read about how Joseph worshipped God. We read about Joseph's vision when Joseph was down in Egypt, and it says that he took an oath of his children in Israel, saying, surely God will visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from hence. Joseph, who was sent by God down into Egypt to be the deliverance of his people when there was a famine in the land. Joseph, who was raised up from God from slavery through prison up to the second in command over the whole land of Egypt, the most prosperous land in the world. But Joseph said, this isn't where God has me.
All right.
Joseph's faith said, God has me with the people of God in that land that God promised our father Abraham. And though I might die here, my bones will not stay here.
That's right.
Take my bones with you, you get out of here. And in Exodus it said, Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he had straitly sworn the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones hence with you. And after Joshua and the children of Israel conquered that promised land, I like it says in the book of Joshua, the bones of Joseph, what the children of Israel brought up with them out of Egypt, they buried in Shechem in that parcel of ground which Jacob bought from the sons of Hamor, the father of Shechem, for 100 pieces of silver, and it came inheritance to the children of Joseph. They took Joseph's bones with them. And when they conquered that promised land, they buried him in a place where Joseph's own children would inherit that land. We read about this legacy of faith and about how those who lived for God were able to demonstrate the faith that was passed on even through their own generations up to us. Even Moses' parents, their courage in sparing the baby Moses from death against the word of Pharaoh. Moses' endurance when he brought Israel through the Red Sea as Pharaoh's army pursued after them. Joshua's victory over Jericho and those cities in Canaan. Rahab. A woman whose life would have condemned her among the condemned people. She was not of the people of God, but she had faith in the God who delivered people from bondage.
Yes. All right.
She said if God can deliver them from the most mighty nation on world, where they were held captive in slavery, God can deliver me from the captivity of my own heart and my own life. And if God will do that for them, even in judgment against my own city, I don't want to be judged in my sins. I don't want to be judged with my city. I want to find freedom with God's people.
Right.
And Rahab found peace. Peace with God by her faith when she hid those spies to save their lives. Her life was spared. And there were too many to list in one chapter of the Bible. Hebrews chapter 11. Too many more. He goes on and he lists a bunch of them. And then he says, I don't have time to write about all of these. And he names a few more. And then he says, and there are so many more that I just don't even have time to name. Too many more to list or to enumerate. But it says in verse 39, these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. The faith of these men and women in the Old Testament, it often resulted in their deliverance from death. That God, by His mighty hand, would bring them through the Red Sea. That God, by His mighty hand, would stop the mouths of lions. That God would do something miraculous to prove to those who saw them living for God by faith, to show them that God is mightier than the powers of this world, the powers of the devil that come against them in this life. Their faith often resulted in deliverance from death. But sometimes they were faithful to God to the death. Yet all of them has since died. Daniel was delivered from the lion's den, but Daniel is dead now. All of them have since died. Noah was spared from the flood, but Noah's dead now.
Yes, sir.
All of them have since died. And it says, these all, having obtained a good report through faith, we read about their faith. We read about how God blessed them.
Right.
Spared them, yes. Delivered them, yes. Worked miracles through them. But they received not the promise. What promise? The promise they looked forward to was the coming Messiah.
Yes.
Right. Because that was the promise given from Genesis chapter 3, right after the fall of Adam and Eve. When they sinned against God, you can read about it, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Says that God was speaking to the serpent, and he said that the seed of the woman would crush the serpent's head,
right.
And that God would send that deliverer to deliver mankind from from the works of the devil.
Amen.
They all looked forward to the promise of the coming Messiah, the deliverer, the Savior. That's what the word Messiah means. Savior. They said, God right now has saved me from this flood. God right now has delivered us from the fire. God right now has spared me from the judgment of this city. But as they knew God was faithful, they knew that God would deliver all who were faithful to Him.
All right.
Amen. They knew that there was someone coming who would spare all who were faithful
yes.
to Him.
Yes.
All who would trust in Him, all who would believe on Him would be spared not just from disasters in this life, but from the judgment of sin in their hearts. And it's through Jesus, the one that John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." It's through Jesus that we have a much greater assurance of life. A much greater assurance of life. Because though Noah lived for many more years after the flood, he died. Mm-hmm. Though Rahab lived for many more years after the destruction of Jericho, she's dead.
That's right. Yes, sir.
Through Jesus, we have the assurance of eternal life.
Yes. Amen.
That those who through faith in God before us came into the world. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live."
All right.
And Jesus has demonstrated His power. That same power that God demonstrated in the lives of all of those of the Old Testament who believed in Him. Jesus demonstrated that same power in the lives of those in the New Testament who trusted in Him. And He said to those who were asking Him about Abraham, He said, "Abraham rejoiced to see my day."
That's right, that's right.
God demonstrated, Jesus demonstrated, Jesus Christ is God.
All right. Amen.
Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. Jesus demonstrated His power to forgive. Jesus demonstrated His power to heal.
Yes.
Jesus demonstrated His power to give life. And the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, "For all the promises of God are in Him, yea, and in Him, amen, unto the glory of God by us." That if we believe in Him, that if we trust in God, then all of the promises that God has given throughout all generations are fulfilled in us by our faith in Jesus Christ.
All right.
Fulfilled in our lives to glorify God through us. Just as God is the one that's glorified by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego being delivered out of fire. Just as God is the one glorified by Daniel being delivered out of the lion's den. Who gets the glory there, Daniel or God? And when we're blessed, when we're spared, when we receive a blessing, who gets the glory, us or God? It's God who's glorified when we are faithful to God. For them, the promises were afar off, yet they believed. For us, the promise of Jesus coming, historically it happened in the past. We've seen Christmas songs, "O Holy Night," "O Little Town of Bethlehem," "Away in a Manger." It happened about 2,000 years ago. The star shining and the wise men from the east following it to where the child lay. But it's present in our lives. That promise fulfilled is present in our lives. Jesus' death and resurrection was long ago. We sing the song sometimes, "Long ago, down on my knees, long ago, I settled it all. Yes, the old account was settled long ago. And my record's clear today, for He washed my sins away when the old account was settled long ago." And a person who just prayed for salvation this morning can say, "Well, my record was settled minutes ago." Oh, but God saw you coming from so long ago.
All right. Amen. Amen.
God saw you coming from so long ago. And He said, "I'm doing this for you."
Yes.
This work that He did 2,000 years ago was for each of us today. Jesus' death and resurrection was long ago. And we didn't see it. We didn't see him beaten when the crowd cried, "Crucify him." We didn't see that crown of thorns on his head and that cross across his back as he walked up that hillside. We didn't see the soldiers jeering and mocking him as they drove those nails into his hand. We didn't see him hanging on that cross up on the hillside. We didn't see it. We weren't with Peter and John as they ran to the tomb when Mary had told them, "He's not there." We didn't see the angels saying, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" But we believe.
Yes.
We believe. For us, it happened thousands of years ago. But the promise is present and fulfilled in our lives today.
Yes, sir. That's right. That's right.
Can we, with that perspective, understand how thousands of years before, the Old Testament figures also believed that God would fulfill what he said he would do,
right,
and that looking forward, they saw the Savior who would come to deliver men and women from their sins and say, "I believe. I believe that God will do what he
Amen.
Said he would do."
Amen.
They believed just as we believe. They acted on that faith just as we act on our faith. Because their faith was in a true God who does keep his word.
Yes, yes.
Their faith was effective in bringing to pass all that they trusted God for. Just as our faith is effective to the salvation of our souls, to bringing to pass all that God has promised in our lives, because we trust in a true God.
Yes, right.
Yeah.
Amen.
We also don't see the Messiah, but we have faith in him today, just as those
yes.
in generations past
Hallelujah.
Believed.
Oh yes.
Jesus said to Thomas, after the disciples told him, "We've seen him risen." And Thomas said, "Unless I thrust my hand into his side where that spear was thrust, unless I put my finger into his hand where those nails pierced him, I will not believe." And it says Jesus stood before him and he said, "Okay, Thomas, put your hand in my
yeah.
side."
Right.
He said, "Okay, Thomas, put your hand in my finger. I'm standing before you. I'm not a spirit. I'm not a ghost. A spirit has not flesh and blood, as you see I have. Touch me, Thomas. See that it's true." Thomas doesn't say it touched him. Thomas believed. And he's often called Doubting Thomas. But he saw Jesus and he said, "My Lord and my God." The one who doubted until he saw was the first one to call the risen Savior God.
All right, all right.
He said, "My Lord and my God." And it said, Jesus said unto him, "Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed." Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, all the rest.
All right.
And each of us. We've got that blessing that God said.
Yes.
Blessed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believe.
Oh, yes. Yes, sir. Amen.
Now the disciples surely had their blessing for seeing him, for faithfulness to him.
Mm-hmm.
Through that ordeal, when they saw him crucified and yet rejoiced at his resurrection, they surely have their blessing. But we've got a blessing that they don't have.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
When Jesus said,
yes.
"Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believe."
Yes.
Just as they, from generations past, have witnessed to us of the power of faith in the true God. It says, chapter 12, "Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses." Their story, their testimony passed down from generations is a witness to us that God is true. That faithfulness to God accomplishes so much. Fulfilling God's will in the lives of those who are faithful to him. "Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which just so easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us." Just as they are witnesses to the power of faith in true God, we can also be witnesses to those in our lives that we can influence for Christ. Today's Father's Day. Proverbs 20, verse 7 says, the just man walketh this in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. A father who walks in integrity, held together is what the word integrity means. Held together by God, sustained by God, by that faith in God that we have. To say, it doesn't matter if everything's falling apart around me, God's got us. And you can live in that example for God, before your family, before your children. It says his children are blessed after him. What is that legacy that you're leaving behind for your children? Is that legacy that God is the one who sustains us? We can be witnesses to those that we can influence for Christ. It says, let us consider one another. Book of Hebrews chapter 10, let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. We influence one another. Another place in the Proverbs, it says, iron sharpeneth iron, as iron sharpeneth iron, so the countenance of one man sharpeneth his friend. We influence one another. Hey, we can make it through this. God is with us. If God be for us, who can be against us? We have a testimony. We have a witness among ourselves. Isn't it a blessing, again, to see somebody else who's doing it, who's serving God, who through their ordeals and trials has trusted God? And we know that God has brought them through. God is working on them through their trials. Their endurance, their patience speaks to us. And if God is doing it for them, I know he'll do it for me.
All right. Amen. Amen.
We can be witnesses to those that we can influence for Christ. And you say, well, I don't know. I don't know who's watching me. I don't know if there's anybody in my life that's watching me. You know, the angels are watching you. The Bible says this also, that our lives are a witness to the angels of heaven. We who trust in God and believe in him by faith, we have that salvation through Jesus Christ that even the angels can't have. And they are amazed when they see natural people living for God by faith through the trials that we face in natural life that they don't face. We endure temptations in natural life against the flesh that they don't face. And we face temptations and we win victories over temptations. That victory in Jesus. By faith in him that they can't claim. They've got their blessings. They've got glory. But the Bible says that they wonder, that they amaze, that they see in us something that testifies to them of the glory of God. Our lives are a witness to more than we can see standing before us with our own natural eyes. But there are those who are watching us in this life. Because the Bible says again in the book of Romans, none of us live to himself. You don't know who's watching you. Whether it's the cashier at the store that you always go to, that you always happen to go in their line. Whether it's somebody that's always coming to your door.
Yes, sir.
Whether it's somebody in the neighborhood that you always wave to, or they always wave to you. There's somebody who sees you more often than you probably even see them. And they say, I wonder if they're living for God today like they said they were yesterday. I wonder if what God is doing in their life will last if I mistreat them today, because there are people that think that way. I wonder how they'll respond if I say a rude word to them instead of a kind word today. And they may not come out and just slug you in the face, but they'll want to see, if they know you're a Christian, they'll want to see Christ in you.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
None of us liveth to himself. We can be an influence. We are witnesses to those who see us as we live for Christ. A witness who can tell another. A witness who can tell another of what God has done to themselves or for themselves in their lives can encourage us. But they're not the ones that give us strength. A witness who says, God did it for me when I was facing a battle. isn't the one that can fight the battle for us.
That's right.
A witness who can say, even as we read their stories from generations past, if you're faithful to God, He'll deliver you from your troubles. Even as David said, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and delivered me from all of my troubles. David, who killed Goliath with that sling and the stone, isn't going to come stand beside you with a sling and take out the giants that are standing beside you, in front of you. They're not the ones that give us the strength that we need to continue. They've already gone on to receive their reward.
That's right.
Continuing on from chapter 11, of course, we go into chapter 12 where it says, wherefore seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. Can you look at, is she playing altar call? You are? Thank you, sister. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. So we have the example of the witnesses, but it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith.
Right.
He's the one who gave us our faith. He's the one in whom our faith is perfected, brought to completion. He's the one who fulfills the promises of God in our life through our faith in Him. He's the one who gives us the victory in every battle that we face through our faith in Him. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Brothers and sisters, we've got a legacy. We've got something that was left to us by one who's gone before us. He's gone before us through that greatest ordeal of all, when He took upon Himself our own sins. When He took upon Himself our own judgment. When He was condemned in our own place in death, yet rose again in life everlasting, that we can claim His life by faith in all that He has done for us. And we've got the testimony of so many others, so many that we haven't met, but we have their accounts recorded for us. So many that we can talk to today that says, yes, He's still doing it for us today. We can believe. We can receive those promises of God, salvation through Jesus Christ. And we can be a witness for another. And we can pass on that legacy to those who come after us.
That's right.
There's another song that says, may all who come behind us find us faithful. But the greatest faithfulness of all is that faithfulness that we have in God our Father. God our Father, who by our faith in Him through Jesus Christ and the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ fulfills every promise that He's given us. And as we bow our heads and close our eyes this morning in reverence to God and out of respect of those who are also here this morning, God, it's our prayer that we be found faithful unto You. You're so good to us. Help us, God, to receive the fulfillment of the promises that we have in You. You're so good to us, God. If our faith wavers, strengthen us, O God. You said in Your word that we ask in faith nothing wavering, but if we lack faith, we can ask of You, and You upbraideth us not. Because You want us to have faith in You, and You strengthen us in our faith when we're weak. All we need, God, we receive. Let it be Your prayer this morning, brother and sister. God, strengthen my faith. Strengthen my faith. That in my faithfulness to You, Lord, I can be an example and a witness to somebody else. God bless you as you pray this morning and seek the Lord.
Thank you.
Things in this world may come against them, and things in this world may change and swirl all around them, but God is so good.
Yes.
God is so good.
Hallelujah.
And when your eyes are on God, you see the goodness of God. When you look up a little bit higher than the circumstances of life, you can be just like Abraham and say, I'm only passing through. I'm only passing through. And what God's got for me is so much better than it is in this life.
Amen.
I'm glad to be serving.
Yes.
And I'm glad that each one of you is here with us, that we're serving God together. Amen. Those of you who are joining on the live stream, I know there's some couldn't be here this morning, but we're thankful for each one.
Come on.
We're glad to be serving our good, good Father.
Amen.
Riverbrook, sir, would you please pray to close the service today?
Heavenly Father, you're so loving and kind and merciful to us. You are truly a good, good Father, Father. That's just, like the song says, just who you are, Father. You do so much for us. Your love, your kindness, and your mercy endure forever and ever, God. We love you and we appreciate you for that, Father. Father, go with us as we depart, go our separate ways. Bring us back to the appointed time, Father, and let the words of this message, Father, rest in place in our heart, Father. Let us live, God, what we learn from you and your word, God, as we go out into our communities doing your will, reaching others for Jesus Christ. We give you the praise, the honor, and the glory this morning forever. In Jesus' name.
Amen.